Amphibious warfare. When these words are usually spoken, the first things that tend to come to mind are battles such as D-Day and Iwo Jima. These battles are without a doubt memorable and influential moments in World War II that helped shape the outcome of said conflict. However, to say these battles were cakewalks misses the finer details of what goes on in such an operation. In this video, I will be going through the basics of amphibious warfare, how to conduct an operation on the offensive, and how to defend against one. Amphibious operations for military purposes were nothing new by the time of the two world wars. As early as 55 BC, Julius Caesar's 7th and 10th Roman legions waded ashore near present-day Kent, the United Kingdom, against British cavalry and spearmen. Likewise, in early 1801, British General Sir Ralph Abercrombie and his forces landed in Aboukir Bay, Egypt, to seize control of the area from the French. Despite stiff resistance against both landing parties, both Caesar and Abercrombie would eventually come out the victors of their respective operations. Since these events, amphibious operations have been viewed by military commanders as risky but doable operations. However, with the Industrial Revolution, warfare as a whole had changed radically, and amphibious operations were no exception. The successes of Caesar and Abercrombie were by that point overshadowed by the disaster known as the Dardanelles Campaign, more commonly referred to as Gallipoli. This last battle instilled the belief in top commanders across the various major military powers around the world that such operations against defended shorelines were no longer viable. Yet, as World War II would prove, such operations were not only possible, but actually feasible given the right circumstances, resources, planning, and equipment, and manpower available. How did this come about? To start off, amphibious operations are no easy feat. Quite the contrary, these are some of the hardest operations any military can ever hope to undertake at any given time. In the words of Colonel Joseph H. Alexander in his book Storm Landings, "Momentum is the essence of any successful amphibious assault against a defended shoreline, but everything involved in delivering combat power ashore degrades momentum." Even under the best conditions, the amphibious commander faces a formidable challenge of stuffing his landing force into small craft and delivering them to the correct beach with sufficient momentum to attack a fortified enemy. It's hard to disagree, considering that landing craft, whether they be small inflatable rubber rowboats or an armored amphibious APC, can carry up to a full squadron of combat-loaded troops. Yet, said troops are vulnerable while they're still buttoned up inside their mode of transportation. This makes them susceptible to taking mass casualties should their vehicle get hit, even if it isn't completely disabled. Upon reaching the beach, said vehicle will have to allow for its troops to disembark and fan out so as to minimize the risk of one shot taking out several targets, while also providing covering fire for said troops. All this has to happen when the vehicle and troops inside are heading into the teeth of enemy defenses concentrated on the beach they are landing on. This is just one of the many challenges inherent with such operations. Another issue faced with amphibious operations is getting the right equipment for the job at hand. For example, the aforementioned dichotomy between a rubber rowboat and an amphibious APC. The rowboat is cheaper and can be made relatively easily. Yet the problem with these kinds of vessels is that they won't do their embarked troops any good should they get stuck on a coral reef or any other obstacle they could run into on the run into the beach. The APC, on the other hand, is armored against small arms fire, carries its troops fully enclosed, and has the ability to continue supporting said troops after they've disembarked with smoke screens and suppression fire from its many weapon systems. Furthermore, an amphibious APC can also traverse over, not all, but most of the obstacles a different craft such as a Higgins boat or the aforementioned rubber rowboat would almost certainly get stuck on. Therefore, an amphibious APC such as the landing vehicle tracked, or LVT, used by the United States Marine Corps during World War II would be the most ideal choice for the job in its respective era. This can also apply to the supporting elements involved in an amphibious operation. For example, do you pick battleships or destroyers as your on-call offshore artillery support element? A few advantages to the destroyers is that they can traverse shallower waters than battleships, can lay onto target faster, and can rapid-fire their primary armaments with sufficient accuracy. Even a 127mm or 5-inch gun is still relatively large for land warfare, as that's a similar caliber to what can be found in a modern main battle tank. Planning is another crucial element to an amphibious operation, on the tactical, operational, and logistical levels alike. The tactical level involves which beaches will the troops land at the areas beyond. What are the defenses like in the area? What are the levels of the sea at high and low tides? What will the weather be like? How quickly should all forces designated to go ashore get there and get off the beach? Meanwhile, the operational level deals with matters relating to the overall force composition of the amphibious forces and their supporting elements, be they air or sea. What kind of ships do you bring? Where will they go to support the troops? What are their primary targets in the early phases? What are the key objectives that the operation seeks to attain? Finally, the logistical level details how you keep the forces onshore supplied as they push inland through resupply of food, fuel, fresh water, ammunition, and replacement parts. Logistics are perhaps the most crucial part of any amphibious operation, as the forces attacking will almost be completely reliant on resupply by the sea, or if you're really ambitious, by air, whereas the defenders will have access to local infrastructure such as roads and railways. The attackers will almost certainly have to seize a major piece of infrastructure such as a port if they wish to keep their forces supplied if they're attacking a major land formation, as was the case with the Western Allies during D-Day, where they had to seize Cherbourg from the Germans in the aftermath of the landings, as the Mulberry artificial ports could only provide a fraction of what the Allies needed to push the Germans out of France. If the attackers are going after a small island in the Pacific, for example, then resupply will usually have to be done via specialized ships with shallow draft, capable of carrying and unloading vast amounts of supplies such as the landing ship tank, as usually the port facilities in those kinds of locations are very limited compared to, say, Cherbourg or Antwerp, if they're even present at all. Finally, whoever has control of the surrounding seas and skies will have a decisive advantage going into the landings themselves. If the attackers have air and or sea superiority, or even supremacy, then they can more easily support their forces while interdicting the enemy's attempts to stop the landings by air or sea. By contrast, if the defenders have superiority at sea or in the air, then any amphibious landing is usually doomed to fail if the attacker is foolish enough to press it. As such, an amphibious assault against a defended shoreline is only ever undertaken when the attackers can guarantee their superiority in forces they bring and can control the surrounding water and airways. The attacker's main goal is to build up enough power and endurance to deliver a knockout blow to the defenders and therefore allow themselves to further their strategic goals. Even then, the result may not be ideal in terms of casualty sustained, as was the case at Tarawa in December 1943, where the US managed to seize the island in its first amphibious operation directly aimed at a contested shoreline, yet suffered heavy casualties, most of which being in the first wave, which was almost completely annihilated. To reduce or outright avoid such high casualty figures, the troops ashore are going to have to be well trained and equipped for the task at hand, as well as be led by capable officers and NCOs going in with them, and be ready to adapt to unexpected changes in the situation. On the other hand, defenders simply need to stay on their feet and parry the enemy's attacks. Defending is always easier than attacking, and once again, amphibious operations are no exceptions. The defenders have the advantages that if they know an attack on their position is imminent, they can make appropriate preparations by digging fortifications, erecting various obstacles, and calling in any available reserve units able to contribute to the defense in one way or another. One of the more common ways to defend against amphibious assaults is a defense at the water's edge, as was seen at Wake Island and the Atlantic Wall in World War II. This approach has the benefit that all the defenses are right up front and able to face the enemy at their most vulnerable, buttoned up in their transports trying to run into the shore and disembark under fire. Furthermore, depending on the tides and the weather, an attacker can expect his grunts to be dashing across open ground, an ideal killing zone for a dug-in defender. However, the downsides to this approach is that being right at the water's edge means exposing the bulk of the defending forces to the preliminary air and naval bombardment that typically precedes the main event, thus leaving them open to being knocked out, disabled, or suppressed by counter-battery fire from the offshore warships. Alternatively, a defense-in-depth approach, as was taken by the Imperial Japanese Army in the late war period at Iwo Jima and Okinawa, offers much more flexibility for the forces available to the defenders, as they can set up several lines of defense should an attacker break through the first line, each getting progressively stronger than the last. This approach also offers the opportunity for the units held in reserve to be brought up to launch a counterattack once the attackers reach a selected line of defense, allowing for a counterpunch that would ideally drive the attackers back into the sea. The downsides to this approach, however, are that with the forces being more dispersed, they cannot wholly concentrate in a single area, should such a move be vital. Furthermore, this approach only works when the defenders have the resources and manpower to be able to both hold the line and launch the aforementioned counterattack. Therefore, the ideal defense against an amphibious assault would be one that combines the best of both approaches mentioned above, with a moderate to strong defense at the front, plus fallback positions should the first line be breached, followed up by a mass counterattack that would drive the encroaching army back into the sea, such as the plans that were drawn up by the Imperial Japanese Army in the run-up to Operation Downfall, the planned invasion of Japan by the Western Allies that, rather thankfully, never came to pass. In conclusion, amphibious operations, particularly those against defended shorelines, are never easy. Both sides have to be thinking one step ahead of their opponents if they wish to achieve victory, come up with the necessary equipment and manpower to either conduct or repel such an assault, and be ready to prepare for unforeseen consequences. Operations of this kind that prove successful, such as D-Day, Saipan, Guam, Tinian, Leyte, Iwo Jima, and Okinawa, are attributed to the skills of the soldiers, strategists, sailors, and pilots that make them possible. And go down in history as shining examples of the capabilities of the troops assigned to carry them out in the nation they fight for. Whereas amphibious operations that are repulsed, such as Gallipoli, the first attack wave on Wake Island in 1941, and the various failed attempts by the IJA and IJM to kick the Allies off Guadalcanal in 1942, can likewise be attributed to the capabilities and tenacity of the soldiers who stood their ground against overwhelming forces and made themselves renowned as a result. Though modern days have seen the dawn of helicopters, tilt rotor, and thrust vectoring aircraft adding a new dimension to amphibious warfare, the complexity of these kinds of operations has not gone away. Rather, it has only grown. In the end, today's amphibious operations and tactics can attribute themselves to the lessons learned the hard way by both sides in the two world wars, and any future amphibious operations will be faced with similar challenges and constraints, ultimately culminating in a battle between an apparently unstoppable force and a supposedly immovable object.
Hey guys, thank you so much for watching. Please remember to leave a like and subscribe and hit the bell icon to be notified about upcoming videos. The source used for this video will be in the description below. Join me next time where I'll be talking about the story of John Rabe.